Bolivia is not the only country in the region that's been experiencing significant political unrest. In fact, right now, protests in Chile against President Sebastián Piñera show no sign of letting up, despite a complete cabinet reshuffle 2 weeks ago. Another example is Ecuador, where the government had to move out of the capital last month because of violent protests. And there's also Brazil, where one left-wing president had been in prison before his release last week. His successor was ousted and her replacement was charged with corruption. Far-right President Jair Bolsonaro is now in power. So joining me now for today's Latin America debrief is Eric Farnsworth, who's Vice President of the American Society and the Council of the Americas. He's in Washington for us. Great to have you on the show, sir. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, Bianca. Thanks for having me.
I think if we could start with trying to get to the bottom of some of these disputed facts about what really happened here with the president's resignation in Bolivia. So Morales is maintaining that this is some sort of coup, that it's harking back to the brutal military takeovers of years gone by. But the opposition, the person who lost out to him to become president, is saying that this was very much a popular movement. What's your assessment?
Yeah, it's really complicated and there's history here. The short answer is that it's not a coup in the traditional sense, certainly. The president, Morales, did lose the support of the military and the police forces, and the head of the military did come out on Sunday and encourage President Morales to depart. Now, some people would say, well, what's the difference, right? Well, there's a nuance here, and the nuance is that the head of the military asked him to depart so that they could restore calm to the streets. Now, that subsequently hasn't happened, but it was really for public order and security. And indeed, President Morales said he would step down so that Bolivia could recover. And it was really on that basis. I think you also have to remember that just before that, on Sunday, the OAS, the Organization of American States, had come out with a really condemning report about the elections that Morales oversaw in October, and which were clearly seen to be fraudulent, and called for Bolivia to rerun those elections. So the political support for the president had been withering. He lost the support of the military, and he decided for his own good and the good of his country, I think, to depart. And now he's in Mexico.
And in terms of the political and almost biographical, psychological trajectory of Morales, he started, you know, the first indigenous president of Bolivia. He was a llama farmer, I think, and he's been in power for 13 years. So what happened here? How did he go from that to somebody who was trying to really push the constitutional limits of power and then, you know, become embroiled in these accusations of fraudulent elections?
Yeah, this is really a shame in some ways, because had he left before this whole anti-constitutional effort to maintain power, his legacy would have been totally different. He was the first president elected as an indigenous person, and you remember that the population, the percentage of population in Bolivia that's indigenous, is really quite large. It's been downtrodden for years, it's been overlooked, it's clearly underprivileged, and to have a president who represents that segment of society is massive, not just in the Bolivian context, but also across Latin America, and we can celebrate that fact. He also brought some economic growth to the country. Certainly he presided during a period of high commodities prices. He was the beneficiary of that, and he did do some things which I think would cause people to say, well, indeed, he wasn't like some of the other populist leaders around South America, but he also exhibited a penchant to want to stay too long, and every leader is going to lose public support over time. But he ran an election, a referendum in 2016 that he lost, and then to allow him to continue in power, then he got the Supreme Court to issue a favorable ruling that said somehow his human rights had been violated by not being allowed to run for the election, and then the election that he ran was fraudulent. So, you know, the people of Bolivia, even many of his supporters, really lost confidence in him and lost support and called out for change, and that's where we are right now.
And Eric, Morales was the last of the original leaders of the pink tide in Latin America.
Yeah.
Do you think that the pressure on him and then his subsequent resignation heralds the end or marks a repudiation of that? Do you think that's the end of that movement, as it were, or its resonance in the region?
Well, it's really hard to say. You know, every country is different, and the voters of each country react to their own personal and individual circumstances. But one thing that we can say is that the pink tide, as you refer to it, really did seem to mirror the commodities super cycle. When commodities prices were high, the populist leaders in the region were elected. They were popular. They ruled with a lot of money sloshing around. As commodities prices over the last couple of years have gone down, there's been a lot less money to circulate, and issues like corruption, issues like anti-democratic governance become much more relevant to the voters. And that's where I think we've seen country after country try to turn a different direction. And what we see quite clearly is that the leaders from the pink tide were all South American leaders, and all of those countries are commodities exporters. So I think that has to be part of the discussion. It probably doesn't explain all of it, but it's certainly a large percentage of it.
Yeah, inextricably linked. Eric Farnsworth, thank you so much for joining us. Appreciate your time today.
Thank you.